and Matt Burt here, and shortly we'll be heading down onto the grid where we have our 9 different winners of 2020 as they take part in a special photo opportunity. But there we go, Matt, there's our 9 different bikes there on the grid, no riders yet. But what a spectacular season it's been. We've had 14 races in 19 weeks. It's been intense, it's been very dramatic, but more than anything, it's been so thoroughly entertaining and largely down to those riders down there.
Yeah, it really has, Amy. It's been a condensed season because of the COVID-19 pandemic, but when we have had racing that started in Jerez back in mid-July, every single Grand Prix has had its own unique story to tell. And for the first time since 2016, yeah, there have been 9 different winners, and it's been a fantastic season.
And 3 of those wins have gone to that man right there, Franco Morbidelli. He is our most recent winner, of course, and it has to be said that when he has, or when he's on his day, he is absolutely spectacular. There's not a lot that can stop him, apart from last weekend. Jack Miller gave it to him pretty good on that last lap, didn't he?
Yeah, I mean, the last of those wins last weekend in Valencia was probably one of the best races we've had all season long. It was certainly the closest finish between Franco Morbidelli and Jack Miller, going all the way down to the last lap. Jack really thought he got it, didn't he, when he took the lead at the first corner, ran a little bit wide, and then there was a couple of really, really good overtakes exchanged between Miller and Morbidelli. But yeah, perfect way to come into this final round and port him out.
And of course, we've had 5 brand new MotoGP winners, one of them being that man right there. And not only is he a brand new MotoGP winner, but he's also our brand new MotoGP world champion. Joan Mir, after getting off to a bit of a rocky start in 2020, showed exactly what consistency can do. And he's now our brand new world champion. We're obviously going to be chatting about him so much in our next, the preview. That will be in about 2 hours' time. But he's been so impressive, Matt.
He's been awesome. Suzuki been awesome. I think it's the first time since Kevin Schwantz and Alex Barros way back in 1994 that Suzuki have had these 2 different winners in a single season. It just brings back all kinds of great memories as well, doesn't it, seeing all the different winners on the grid. We just saw there briefly Brad Binder, you know, who for me was probably the biggest surprise win of the entire season.
Well, absolutely. It was only his 3rd race in the MotoGP class, and he was the first MotoGP rookie since Marc Marquez to take a win in his rookie season. He was obviously the first rider to win for KTM since they rejoined the World Championship, and the first South African to win in the MotoGP class. He took a lot of accolades home that day, didn't he?
He really did. It's almost like every single winner so far this year was set some milestone or broke some record. You can see there Andrea Dovizioso and Brad Binder, I'm sure, for the first time getting a proper chance to fully congratulate Joan Mir, the new world champion. And his 2 young men, of course, as well, have been fantastic this year. Who would have thought coming into this season, Franco Morbidelli on last year's Yamaha has now won the same amount of races as Fabio Quartararo. Those 2 now, the top 2 men in this season, they've won 3 races each. So a bit of bragging rights down in that pit box this weekend to see who can seal the deal on the most wins in 2020.
Absolutely. But all of the Yamaha wins actually started with Fabio Quartararo. Now, oh my gosh, we started this 2020 season, and after those first initial 2, especially the second one in Jerez, we thought there was absolutely nobody that could stop Fabio this year. What a turn of events.
It looked like he was going to steamroll the championship like Marc Marquez did last year. Of course, the season started in such dramatic fashion. When we thought we were going to have this picture posed at the start of the year, who could have believed that it would not feature the old world champion now, Marc Marquez? You can see there Miguel Oliveira, of course, what a weekend for him, racing a MotoGP bike for the first time on home soil. He gets to congratulate Joan Mir as well. But Fabio Quartararo made such a sensational start. I mean, he was dominant in those 2 first races, and we thought it was going to run away with the championship. Love that. That's fantastic. Yeah. I mean, these 2 have been close rivals, former teammates, of course, in Moto3 back in the day. And what they've all said to a man is that Joan Mir is, without any question, a richly deserving MotoGP world champion this year. Amy, he's only won 1 Grand Prix. Yes, that's true. But he's been able to, as we've talked about, marry consistency and speed so brilliantly on that GSX-RR. Nobody scored more podiums than him this year. And he's been absolutely brilliant. So many people are happy for him, for Suzuki. They're back on the top step for the first time in 20 years in the World Championship.
Well, we say he's only won one race, but there was, of course, that race in Austria where he came so agonizingly close. And if it wasn't for the red flag that was brought out, I'm sure that race it was for Maverick Vinales, when his bike, unfortunately, their brakes didn't work at a particularly frightening moment. And then, unfortunately, it meant that Juan had to head back out on already used tires. I think they already had like 12 laps on them or something like that, hey?
I'm so happy that Juan Mir did take a victory this season, and it came in Valencia a couple of weeks ago, which set him up brilliantly for that first match point last week. And there's been all the talk, hasn't there? Is he going to be the first Premier Class world champion in history to take the title without ever winning a race? And there was all these people saying, oh, well, you know, it won't be the same because Marc Marquez is not here. It won't be the same because he's not won a race. Absolute rubbish. And like you said, Amy, he was well on course to win that race in Styria. He was 2.5 seconds clear of Taka Nakagami, and then that red flag came out, the whole incident with Maverick Vinales. And since then, he's come close. I'm sure that Juan Mir would have won a lot more races this year if he could sort out his performances in FP3 and in qualifying to get into Q2, because grid positions this year have cost him. He's been so strong in races that actually, if he does qualify better, then it's probably going to spell quite a lot of trouble for the guys next year.
Well, we said that so many times about the Suzukis, but then we go back to Alex Rins' recent win from 10th on the grid. Yep. That was seriously impressive. And we said it before, Matt, you have to believe that had Alex Rins not been injured in that first Jerez race with the dislocated and fractured shoulder, there perhaps would have been a few more that would have gone his way.
So many different stories to tell about this year's championship. I mean, like you say, Alex Rins, Amy, I mean, his championship challenge was really, really blunted right from the get-go. That horrible injury he suffered, the right shoulder injury, that high-speed crash in qualifying in Jerez. I mean, Franco Morbidelli, what a different story it could have been for him this year. Of course, he had the mechanical in Jerez when he was well set for the podium, completely innocently wiped out in Austria in that horrendous incident involving Joan Zarco and then Maverick Vinales and Valentino Rossi afterwards. But you can sort of say that about every rider in this group, because Juan Mir, he'd have had the championship wrapped up a long time ago had he not fallen off in Jerez and then been wiped out by Ike Lekuona in the third round in Brno. I mean, I think after Brno, Fabio Quartararo was over 45 points clear of Juan Mir in the championship. And even at that stage, I think some people were going, Juan Mir is out of this. It's a condensed, shortened season. Two DNFs in the first three races. He's not going to be able to claw that back. So it shows what an exceptional job that young man who we're looking at right now did to find his consistency, find his speed, and crucially find that winning touch, which makes him a brilliant world champion.
Well, we come here to the final race of the season, and really, up until a few races ago, we were kind of expecting a four-way battle. A four-way battle that included Andrea Dovizioso, who is about to race his final race, as far as we know. Will this be his swan song? We'll have to wait until further notice on that one. But good that he did actually get a win in Austria. Until Miguel Oliveira's win, he was actually keeping that Ducati record at the Red Bull Ring firmly intact. But Andrea Dovizioso will definitely leave or look back on this year and think, what if?
I was just laughing. I could see everybody else was ready apart from Maverick. I guess he didn't get the memo. Just rushing Maverick to get on the grid. But yeah, Andrea Dovizioso, Amy, it's not been the season that he was anticipating at all, has it? I mean, I think people felt that as soon as Marc Marquez was taken out of the equation very early on that horrendous crash, he had that season-ending right arm injury. People thought, well, Dovi was going to be the man, runner-up the last 3 years. He was really thrown a huge curveball by that new Michelin compound rear tyre this weekend. And even now, what, we're coming to round 14 and he still hasn't really got any clear direction or with the setup or with his riding style on that motorcycle. So it's been a very, very difficult ending, or what we think might be an ending, to his Grand Prix career this weekend. Here he is. I think Franco Morbidelli there just giving him a sarcastic
round of applause. Obviously, Maverick Vinales was the winner of our second race in Misano. We'll talk about that in a little bit later on, because I just want to introduce the fact that we've obviously said we've had five brand new MotoGP winners, and there could have also been a sixth, because you'll remember that actually until at the point where Pecco Bagnaia crashed out, he was looking so good for that win there.
Yeah, and that was, of course, when that's what helped Maverick Vinales take his win in Misano. Five new winners in the Premier Class for the first time. What a year as well. This picture gives you an indication as well. What a fantastic year. Yes, Suzuki will take the plaudits quite rightly. They're on course for the Triple Crown. They've already won the team championship. They won the rider championship with Mir. They can win the constructor title this weekend. But two KTMs there as well, Amy, coming into this championship. Who would have thought that KTM would be winning in MotoGP? They only joined this championship full-time in 2017. And I don't think too many people, I think if you'd have said at the start of the year, KTM will win this year, you'd have probably put a lot of money on it being Pol Espargaró. Of course, he's come really, really close, but it's Brad Binder and Miguel Oliveira, who are the two KTM men that have done the business this year. Fantastic to see. A lot of different young, different talents with different riding styles, different backgrounds, and different motorcycles as well. That's what's made this year so special. And another thing to point out as well, there is not a single Honda in that picture. I mean, who would have thought coming into this year as well that Honda would not win a MotoGP race this year? Of course, not helped at all by the fact that Marc Marquez had that serious right arm injury right from the get-go, but no Honda. I think it's the first time since they returned to the championship in 1982 they've not won at least one race. They've still got one more crack at it, though, of course, on Sunday.
Well, it has been a crazy topsy-turvy year. And for the first time in a very long time, we actually had our first wet race when we were back in Le Mans. Obviously, joining KTM next year will be Danilo Petrucci. He, too, also races his final race in red for the Bologna Bullets. I'm glad, again, that he finished his Ducati career off with a win, because perhaps similarly to Andrea Dovizioso, this year has not been the year that they were expecting at all.
No, I mean, Danilo Petrucci, I mean, I think he was quite thankful for the chance to sort of show Ducati that he was still a top winning potential race rider, that rain conditions that came in Le Mans. I mean, Fabio Quartararo looked such a big favourite for that race, and it rained, didn't it, what, just 3 minutes before the start of the Grand Prix. So many of these riders have found it difficult to replicate wins. I mean, Andrea Dovizioso won that race in Austria, hasn't even on the podium since. Maverick Vinales likewise after his win in Misano. Fabio Quartararo struggled dismally for form since he won in Barcelona. It just shows you the kind of unpredictable nature of this year's championship. And we keep talking about all the problems that Yamaha have had. They've had 7 wins so far this year. They've won more than half the races. People think it's been a bad year for Yamaha, but they're having their best year in terms of wins since 2015.
The riders are now getting on their bikes. And of course, like we've said, we've got one race to go. One race left in 2020. Give us your best guess, Matt, at who could potentially take the win, the final win of 2020. Will it be a 10th different winner? I just think there's a few names. There's a few riders that have got some business to finish. And I think one of them from my side has to be Jack Miller.
And you wouldn't put it past there being a 10th different winner here on Sunday, would you? This circuit in Portimao, it's like a roller coaster. And this season has been a roller coaster in every sense of the word. I think you've just mentioned Jack Miller. He's going to be a strong candidate this weekend, Amy. Pol Espargaró, we know he is going to be going all out to try and win on his final appearance for KTM. Poor old Taka Nakagami, will he be there as well? I mean, Taka, unfortunately, crashed out of the podium places yet again last week, but that shows what an incredible season in MotoGP has been. 9 different winners in 13 Grand Prix. I really hope, actually, it'll be a fitting way to end the season if we get a 10th different man on the top step.
They'll have to, like, superimpose him at them on the back left there.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Maybe
your Photoshop skills coming in on Monday back in Barcelona HQ.
Your theory of that photo missing a Honda could really turn around, because... Yeah.
Taka's going to ruin that one now, isn't he, on Sunday.
Anyway, let's go back to this weekend and talk a little bit more about the men that potentially could change that photo somewhat. And let's go back to Taka Nakagami, because 3 races now, he's been on the front row. He said last time out that he's finally kind of got over this pressure, this fear that gets into his head a little bit from being in that front row. What do you think is the missing piece of the puzzle, Matt?
I think it's just at the moment that experience of consistently running at the front in MotoGP races. That's what he's lacking compared to some of the other riders. I mean, he looked so good again, didn't he, last weekend? I mean, Pol Espargaró, when he got passed by Taka, he thought he had the pace to go on and win the race. So, yeah, Taka's going to have another shout this weekend, because, of course, they're all coming into it completely blind. They've only ridden here, really, on street bikes at that test a few weeks ago. So this is anybody's. This could be one of the most unpredictable races we've seen of the season so far, and there's been quite a few of them.
There's been some absolute belters. I just remember going back to Brad Binder's win, just how... Yeah. Emotional that was. It was, like you said, quite unexpected. He definitely was showing some promise in the pre-season, but but nobody expected him in his third MotoGP race to go out there and win Bruneau.
It's been such a pleasure and a privilege this year to commentate on so many important moments in these guys' careers. Fabio's first win, Joan Mir's first win in World Championship, Frankie's first win, Brad Binder and Miguel Oliveira's first wins in MotoGP as well. And Brad Binder's victory in Bruneau, I think that was probably the most shocking win of the season. Nobody expected that in just his third Grand Prix of the year. And there is Dorna CEO, of course, Carmelo Ezpeleta, who's done so much behind the scenes to make sure we've had a 15-round championship in Moto2 and Moto3 and a 14-round championship this year in MotoGP. You don't see the work that goes on behind the scenes during these very difficult times to put these races on, and it's been absolutely fantastic. And I think a lot of credit must go to Carmelo, because we've had an amazing show this year because of all the work that he's put in behind the scenes, not just this year, but over the last four, five, even longer years as well.
It's been a mammoth effort to get this show back on the road, considering everything that the world was going through with the global pandemic. But like you said, Matt, of course, we've missed not having the fans. We really hope to see you guys back at a circuit soon in the future. But hopefully the small consolation will be that the races were just so, so exciting.
Yeah, every race, as we said, has had its own different special story. I don't think this weekend's going to be any exception as well, coming to a completely new circuit. Will it be, for the first time ever in Premier Class history, double figures for winners in the campaign? Love that shot as well, because it highlights how much great young talent is coming through the ranks from Moto3 and Moto2, and it shows with all the different bikes as well how competitive MotoGP is nowadays too.
Well, Suzuki rejoined the World Championship just six seasons ago, back in 2015. I spoke to Davide Brivio after the race, and also Ken Kawachi, their technical director, and both of them admitted they had absolutely zero idea what they would be able to achieve in six short seasons. I'm going to delve on and in with that with you a little bit later on in the preview, which will be at 4:40 local time. Do remember that we have an hour's difference. We're actually on UK time, which works very well for you and I. But if you are in Europe, you need to put your clocks forward, back. Which
back.
Way around it is.
Yeah,
we've been away so long, I'm just like completely confused over what time is absolutely normal now. But that was fantastic. We hope you enjoyed that photo opportunity with our nine different winners in 2020. Will we see a 10th one this weekend? We definitely do not have long to find out. We've got some special extended free practice sessions this weekend, so all riders can get to grips and familiarise themselves with the track. That'll be with Matt Burt and Steve Day.
Yeah,
hope you got your throat lozenges ready.
A bit of overtime coming this weekend. Yeah, looking forward to those extended sessions. Yeah, 45 minutes to 70 minutes, 50 minutes of extra track time for the MotoGP boys to really get their heads around this amazing Portimao circuit. I mean, we were fortunate yesterday to walk the track, and I'd heard nothing but good stories about it. It is absolutely incredible.
Yeah.
Jaw-dropping circuit. Can't wait to see what it's like when there's 300 horsepower MotoGP bikes firing around it tomorrow.
A really special one to look forward to and finish off this 2020 season. But like we said, we'll be back at 4:40 local time. But from myself and Matt Burt for now, it's goodbye.